this video, we'll compare Ruby, no Rails, just Ruby, with Node.js standard library. In the previous video, I made a mistake by comparing Ruby on Rails, a large framework with extensive middleware, and Active Record with bare bones Node.js. Soon after, I received a pull request from Konstantin with a pure Ruby implementation, which he claimed he had improved by 25 times. Naturally, I had to test it, so I released updated benchmark. I also made some configuration changes and optimizations specific to Kubernetes, which I'll cover in the next section. As always, we'll measure latency using P99 percentile from the client side with identical histogram buckets. For throughput, we'll measure how many requests per second each application can handle. We'll also measure saturation of the services, focusing on CPU usage relative to the pod limit and memory usage. And of course, we need to measure CPU throttling, since we run these tests in Kubernetes. Finally, we'll measure error rates or availability of each application. In the second test, my goal is to simulate a real-world use case by adding a relational database. Additionally, we'll measure latency of saving an item to a relational database for each language, as well as CPU usage of the database, in this case, Postgres database. I run all my tests in Envious to make them more realistic, using exact same infrastructure as I use in my production environments. I use M7A large instances to run applications and 4 extra large Graviton instances to run clients. Additionally, I use specialized I3EN extra large EC2 instance with a local SSD disk to host Postgres. The average cost to run these tests is between $20 and $50 per benchmark. To run my tests, I used Terraform to create all infrastructure from scratch for each test. I set up VPC with all necessary networking components, such as NAT and internet gateways, along with a couple of subnets. If you want to replicate this setup, I have a full course on my channel. Next, I create a production-ready EKS cluster with 2 instance groups. Since Node.js is famously a single-threaded application, or at least most of the work is done on a single thread, you can scale it by either using a cluster mode or in Kubernetes by limiting each pod to 1 CPU share and scale it horizontally. For example, a large EC2 instance has 2 CPUs, so I deploy 2 pods on a single EC2 instance to utilize all available resources. I do the same for the Ruby application, running a single worker per pod with a different number of threads in each test, which I'll explain later. I use Tains and Affinity to ensure that these pods are collocated and deployed on their own nodes in Kubernetes. I also create a second instance group based on Graviton instances, which are cheaper and IRM based to run my clients. For load generation, I use Kubernetes jobs to deploy 20 pods per application. For the second test, I provision EC2 instance outside of Kubernetes for the Postgres and use Route 53 private hosted zone for the service discovery. In the first test, I send a GET request to each application, and it returns hard-coded objects to the client. For the second test, when I send a POST request with a JSON payload, each application parses that payload, generates UUID and timestamp, saves the object to a relational database, and returns that object with ID generated by the database. I use returning keyword in SQL, which is a very common practice. For Node.js, I use the standard library to implement a simple HTTP server with a few endpoints. We have slash metrics endpoint that returns internal Prometheus metrics for database latency, slash health endpoint for Kubernetes health checks, and slash API slash devices endpoint that returns a few hard-coded objects in response to a GET request, which are identical between these two applications. I also have the same slash API slash devices endpoint to handle POST requests. First, it parses JSON payload from the client, generates UUID along with a current timestamp and save this object to a database. I use the fastest available Node.js Postgres driver for the database and exactly the same SQL query as in the other application. Additionally, I use Prometheus with a histogram with a lot of buckets to improve accuracy and record the duration of each insert query. I only measure latency for the successful requests, but in practice, you should measure failures as well, as they are also essential, because timeouts can significantly impact user experience. For this test, I use the latest available Node.js version 23.1.0. On the other hand, we have Ruby application. As you can see, it no longer uses Rails. This application also has a few endpoints. First, there is /API/devices endpoint, which handles both GET and POST requests. Instead of health endpoint for Kubernetes, it follows a different naming convention, but it does exactly the same thing. /metrics endpoint is created by the Prometheus client internally, so we don't need to define it explicitly in the app. For GET requests, application returns same devices as Node.js using application/JSON header. For POST requests, application parses JSON payload, generates UUID and timestamp, and then uses a connection pool to save the object to the database. Prometheus is used with the same labels to measure request duration. Histograms bucket are also identical, which helps make the test results more accurate. You might notice environment variable named Rails max thread, but there is no Rails here. This is just a variable name from a previous test. There is important difference in how connection pool works. In Node.js, you can create as many independent connections as you like within a single thread. In Ruby, however, the connection pool is limited by the number of threads in the application. Even if you set the pool size to 100, it will still be limited to the number of threads. This is particularly important for the second test. After experimenting with different settings, I found that the best performance with lower latency in the first test is achieved using a single thread, which is the same number as in Node.js. However, in the second test, using a single thread limits Ruby to just one database connection, creating a bottleneck. When I tested this, Ruby's throughput was significantly reduced. For the second test, I tried a few options and finally decided to use 10 threads, which allows for 10 connections in the pool. I also limited Node.js to 10 connections to maintain consistency. Also, I use Postgres Prometheus exporter to monitor database connections in real time. For versions, I use latest Ruby 3.3.5, and it uses the same C library as ZAP framework, which is based on Zeek language and produces similar results, as you can see in one of my previous tests. Alright, let's go ahead and run the first test. Right from the start, you can see that Ruby not only has lower latency, but also uses less CPU, which is often a bottleneck for throughput. I've tested different thread settings and optimizing application in Kubernetes with limits and C groups is very different from VMs or bare metal servers. If you create two threads or more for Ruby application, surprisingly, the latency increases and Kubernetes throttles it sooner. I explained this behavior with C groups in one of my previous benchmarks. The important part is that in Kubernetes, if you're running a CPU-intensive application, you ideally want to limit the number of threads to match the CPU shares defined in the pod limit. I tested this with Go language, and this rule seems to hold for Ruby application and the underlying C library it uses. At around 40% CPU usage, you can notice that Node.js starts getting throttled by Kubernetes, which results in higher latency. Kubernetes will continue to throttle it throughout the test. You can also see downward spikes in availability for the Node.js application. Since I use two pods per application, the graphs show average CPU and memory usage per application. At around 35,000 requests per second, Node.js can no longer keep up with Ruby and begins dropping some requests. This is consistent with other tests I ran with Node.js on this EC2 instance type. Even though Node.js was able to reach 50,000 requests per second. It's not very stable, and it shows significant drops in availability at this level. So let's see how much more Ruby can handle. By around 90% CPU usage, Ruby was able to reach almost 80,000 requests per second. If you look at my previous benchmark of Rust with ZAP framework, which uses the same C library, you'll notice that ZAP was able to handle nearly the same amount, around 84,000 requests per second. In that test, I used a slightly smaller payload, which might explain the difference. To be honest, I think we're not really testing Ruby versus Node.js in this test, but rather underlying C library with Node.js. But anyway, let's continue. Now, let me open each graph for the entire test duration. First, we have request per second graph. You can see that around 27,000 requests per second, Node.js started dropping requests and ultimately reached only 50,000 requests per second. Ruby, on the other hand, handled up to 80,000 requests per second. Next, we have latency. Ruby's latency is consistently lower throughout the test, including at the start, and of course, lower is better. Then we have CPU usage. Node.js uses more CPU and was throttled by Kubernetes earlier, which resulted in higher overall latency. Next is memory usage, which doesn't really play a role in this test. In some cases, like with Go standard library, high memory usage can reduce throughput by caching requests when overloaded, potentially forcing Kubernetes to kill the pod with out-of-memory error. However, in this case, memory usage doesn't affect latency or throughput. Next is availability graph. I have 100 millisecond timeout on the client side, and when the threshold is reached, availability drops. Finally, we have CPU throttling. You'll see very little throttling on the Ruby side because I used a single thread. If you increase the number of threads, throttling becomes much greater. That concludes the first test. Alright, let's run the second test. Here I had to increase the number of threads Ruby uses, which degraded its performance. However, if I kept it at one thread, the database would have been a bottleneck. In this test, Node.js and Ruby went head-to-head in terms of CPU usage and database latency, with Ruby's CPU usage even higher than Node.js at certain points. I also measured Postgres CPU usage to ensure that database itself didn't become a bottleneck, as it did in some of my previous tests. At around 7,000 requests per second, Kubernetes began throttling Ruby, likely due to multiple threads. The more threads you use beyond the available CPU shares, the more likely Kubernetes is to throttle. Latency spikes appeared around at the same time, which was expected. At this point, it seems that Node.js might outperform Ruby, but at around 10,000 requests per second, Kubernetes began throttling Node.js, causing it to fall behind Ruby. Looking at the Postgres CPU usage graph, you can see that database load decreased due to Node.js failures. So let's see how much more Ruby can handle. Ruby reached 12,000 requests per second at around 90% CPU usage, when it maxed out and couldn't process additional requests. Now, let's review each graph for the entire test duration. First, a request per second graph. Node.js reached nearly 10,000 requests per second before failing. It attempted to recover but failed again shortly after, while Ruby reached almost 13,000 requests per second. Next is the client latency, which remained similar throughout the test until Node.js started to fail. Then, database latency. Most of the Node.js client latency comes from the database, indicating it's a bottleneck. It's possible that 10 connections per application are not enough, so it's important to pay attention to dependencies like databases or caches when optimizing performance. At the start of the test, database latency was similar for both applications. I initially tried 1 and 2 threads for Ruby, which gave much lower latency at the beginning. However, since Ruby's database connections equal to the number of threads, this quickly became a bottleneck. Next, Postgres CPU usage, which reached 70 to 80%. Let me know if I should use a larger instance type for the database to prevent it from becoming a bottleneck. I also used pgtune to optimize for the hardware with 400 connection limit. If you have experience, I would love your thoughts on the optimal connection limit for the Postgres. Next, application CPU usage. In this test, the difference in usage between applications was much smaller. Then we have memory usage. Availability graph shows a few drops for Node.js application. Finally, CPU throttling. Ruby relies on its C library to boost performance, but this approach has limitations for database and other service integrations when essentially creating a wrapper around more efficient libraries. Due to this, I personally wouldn't choose Ruby over Node.js, but what do you think? I have other benchmarks on my channel that you might find interesting, and you definitely want to check Ruby versus Zap, which uses the same C library. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.